And I don't give a damn how you look at it. There are efforts to stop people from voting. That's not right. This is not Russia. This is the United States of America.
And James Farr here, live from Pasadena Media Studios. Get ready for more piercing and provocative. The Conversation Live starts now. And welcome to another episode of The Conversation Live. The Conversation Live focuses on social justice, restorative justice, inclusion, and equality. Coming up today on The Conversation.Live, we may going to have a pretty critical and possibly uncomfortable conversation. Former Pasadena Mayor Jacque Robinson-Baisley is in the seat. And I want to catch up with Jackie and kind of find out what life has been after politics. Certainly going to ask that question that you all want to know. It's election season. We're in full swing with everything, both nationally and locally. I also want to talk with Jackie about her interests and her future. We know it's the year of the woman, and I want to get some reaction from her on that one. But first, coming up, we want to take a look at the legacy of the Honorable Elijah Cummings in his recent passing. Let's go ahead and roll that clip in, Bubba.
Baltimore Congressman Elijah Cummings died on Thursday. The chairman of the House Oversight and Reform Committee appeared on this broadcast several times over the years, the latest this past January. Elijah Cummings' awareness of the moral and ethical obligations of public office gave weight to the distinctive voice of this son of sharecroppers.
I stand on the shoulders of the people who have been unseen, unnoticed, unappreciated, and unapplauded. But now I'm a run a race for them. And hopefully, there'll come a day when I pass my baton. But in the meantime, I have faith in this democracy. I do. And I refuse to give up.
And welcome back.
We've been hearing it over and over again.
Welcome back, Jackie. Thank you so much for being here with me.
Thank you for having me.
It is. I've been wanting to sit down with you for quite some time, and you know we've known each other for many years. I followed you in many different spaces, your career and stuff. But you know, I just wanted to first we look at the Honorable Elijah Cummings and his recent passing. And you know, he was here in Pasadena, which he spoke here and he talked about his death. What's your reaction? What was his impact on you?
Well, first of all, like much of the country, when I woke up that morning that he passed and saw the news on Twitter and all the social media sites, it just kind of took my breath away because, you know, you don't expect that type of news, especially from someone who's been so vocal and in the news cycle as of lately with regard to his work against the current administration and others. And so I was saddened by the news, but I also was also grateful that myself and my husband had an opportunity to meet him here in Pasadena when Lena Kennedy led his visit here to Pasadena at first.
Bubba, pull up the picture of Jackie and Marcus and the congressman, as well as we want to see some of that B-roll footage so that folks can see his talk at Friendship Church. What did he share with you? I mean, because you, in one respect, you're standing on his shoulders. And so did he have any advice for you? I know you weren't in office at that time.
I was not.
So what did he share with you?
I mean, I actually did not ask him for any particular, you know, electoral political advice. I think that the words that he spoke to the congregation that was there at the services that day was essentially one of hope, and that, you know, as stated in some of the clips that we've seen over the course of the last several days, you know, the work that we're doing right now, it's incumbent upon all of us to be vocal about the things that we need to and to speak up when we see that there's a wrong or an injustice taking place. And that applies not just to his constituents in Baltimore, but all of us all over the nation.
Yeah, I mean, I found it interesting. I wasn't able to attend, but, you know, he spoke about his death. Mm-hmm. You know, at Friendship, he talked about for the last 6 months prior to that, him being in a hospital. Mm-hmm. And, you know, after having his knee surgery and, you know, and then here we are not too many months later, mm-hmm. this actually mm-hmm. happened. So, you know, he obviously had been speaking about it and, you know, right. possibly foresaw it coming. But he's, you know, just a tremendous man and did a lot of great things. Let me check in real quick. You're watching The Conversation Live. The Conversation Live focuses on social justice, restorative justice, inclusion, and equality. My guest today is Jacque Robinson-Baisley, and she is in the seat today, and we're just having a conversation. I know what everybody wants to know. We'll get to all of that at some point. But I really want to talk to Jacque and just Jacque, the person, Jacque, the woman. I know the Year of the Woman was a big thing in 2018. It's still something that we're hearing about now, especially with this election cycle that we're in. So, Bubba, go ahead and roll in segment three, video one, and then we'll talk with Jacque on the other side a little bit more about politics.
We've been hearing it over and over again.
A record number of women.
A surge of first-time female candidates.
It's all part of a national wave of women.
Women are running for office in record numbers. And 2018 is being called the Year of the Woman.
Probably most people, when I said I was going to run for this seat, thought, you know, go for it. Have fun.
There was a lot of changes that I wanted to implement on the federal level. And so when the opportunity arose to run for Congress, I jumped for it.
I didn't see any women stepping forward to run in my congressional district. And so I said, you know what, if no one else is going to do this, let's go. I'll run.
I think a lot of the excitement and energy that we're seeing in 2018 is a result of Donald Trump's victory. From the minute he took office, organizations that train female candidates reported a surge in the number of people interested in their program, and a lot of that translated into activism.
Show me what!
Women thought they had a voice, but realized they didn't. And so it's almost like now people are just a little pissed. They're a little angry and say, no, I thought we had a voice. Well, I guess we don't. Well, here I go.
This time around, women don't want to just be a part of the conversation. They want to drive it.
I mean, we all have these expectations. There should be more women. Why don't we have more women? Why aren't more women running? It's tough to run for government. And it is.
Welcome back. Year of the Woman. But I don't want to talk about politics right now. I want to talk about you as a person. I mean, because when you were in office last, you weren't married.
No, I was not.
You did not have a beautiful little girl.
No, I did not.
So how does this, if you go back to the little girl Jacque, you know, the Jacque at John Muir High School, the Jacque in Pasadena, mm-hmm. The Jacque fussing with Josie.
That still exists today.
That still exists today. Never mind. Did you ever think that you would become the vice mayor of Pasadena, California, your home city, growing up?
You know, I did not. It was not something that I thought about. It was not something that I saw reflected in the community at the time. I can't remember the exact year, but I believe Chris Holden was, of course, a member of the city council. But, you know, I was just a regular little black girl from Pasadena, being welcomed and encouraged by my teachers and friends and family in the city. Yes, I was involved in student government when I was in high school, but there was no intentional plan to one day run for office and eventually become council member and vice mayor.
Because as an elected official, I mean, you essentially should be an advocate for your constituents. Mm-hmm. Was it when you went up to Berkeley, did a little bit of that activism kind of catch you?
I mean, for sure, my time at Berkeley was the spark in me becoming more vocal, becoming more outgoing with issues that were pertinent at the time. And actually, it's when I came back to Pasadena that I received the encouragement yet again from women in this community to consider running for office at the time, which was in late 2006. There was an ice cream social. And women were concerned at the time about there no female representation on the school board and mm-hmm. council. And they encouraged all of us to go amongst our networks and ask people, did they want to run? And at the time, I didn't think much of it. I asked my older, you know, teachers, mentors, other women that I believed at the time were more experienced than I was to run. Mm-hmm. And they all said no. And I didn't get the picture, but you know, one day I just thought in my mind, why can't I run? Why doesn't my experience count for something? And so I took that and I ran with it with their support and others, and I was eventually elected to District 1.
You know, interesting, I mean, because at that time we had you and Margaret, and now there's just Margaret.
Yes.
And she's decided that she's gonna, she's not seeking re-election.
Yes, and very much understandable, and of course our prayers are with her and
balance,
her husband.
Balance of family. But why is it important to have that diversity? And before you answer that, I think we tend to, if we aren't looking through the right lens, I actually didn't even notice that there was or was not a woman on the council. And I, for that, I mean, somebody checked me on that, mm-hmm. you know, and I'm like, oh, there's only one. And as much as I go to
I think it's just because we're used to it. Mm-hmm. We're used to not seeing women visibly in positions of leadership, and our council is no exception to that rule. Even with the addition of myself and Councilmember McGossin, who were both elected in 2007, there's only been 7 women in total mm-hmm. in the history of the city that have been elected to the city council. And that's a problem leading into 2020 and the anniversary of women's suffrage, who we also know at the time, you know, did not include black women mm-hmm. as well. And so I think those are points that we need to remember. And I'm glad to see that there are a number of women this election cycle that are expected to run. Charbland in District 4, mm-hmm. Felicia Williams in District 2. And, you know, the nomination period is not open yet.
Open.
And so, you know, there still very well may be others.
What did Joy Streeter, because you preceded Joy Streeter, what did she share with you, you know, as you were kind of walking into this new space of office?
I mean, she was generally supportive. By my recollection, I don't think she formally endorsed me, but she was definitely supportive and shared with me her experience as a member of the city council. And of course, you bring yourself to your leadership roles. There's no way that I can erase being a female, or at the time being the youngest, or being a black female amongst a room full of men, essentially. And you know, I think those experiences that you bring, whether it's gender or ethnicity or profession or otherwise, those are pertinent as the council makes its decisions.
Now, I mean, is it different for a woman, you know, and you know, having to balance family and other commitment, or is there a different expectation for a woman when you're?
I think it's more that there's a different expectation, and I think that expectation is what leads some women to not even consider their personal qualifications in running, deciding to run for office or being a candidate. You know, now that I'm a mother, mm-hmm. I have a very much so a new and a greater appreciation for mothers all over this community. It is the hardest job in the world. And that by itself, you know, many people are criticized for being stay-at-home mothers, but, you know, being a stay-at-home mother is a great feat, and possibly even more work than a mother who is also working and, you know, possibly has to pay for childcare and other factors. And so, again, your personal experience is what makes being a member of those governing bodies important.
Let me check in real quick. You're watching The Conversation Live. The Conversation Live focuses on social justice, restorative justice, inclusion, and equality. My guest today is Jacque Robinson-Baisley. And she corrected me. I made the mistake the last round. And I'm working on it. But I want to talk a little bit more about Jacque. You know, because I mentioned earlier, she served on our city council and eventually ran for mayor and lost to the current incumbent mayor, Terry Tornick. But I want to take a look at something that you said at council. So, Bubba, let's go and roll in segment 4, video 1, please.
Like Mr. Tornick, I consider myself to be represented, or to represent the city as a whole, as much as I consider myself a representative of District 1. So I look forward to working with those members of the downtown district. And I actually view it as a advantage that you have the, what I view as an advantage of being represented by 3, or it might be even 4 council members. What I view as an advantage of being represented by 3, or it might be even 4 council members, because we all know 5 is the magic number on this city council, and in light of anything that you're going to want to get done in the future, I would think that it's a plus being able to start out. If you presume the fact that your council member starts out in your corner, that, you know, you're starting off with a good 3 votes. So, again, thank you to the commission, and I will support the recommendation tonight.
Welcome back. So you're sitting on that dais. I mean, you bring a different experience and lens because you're born and raised here, you were educated here, your family's here, you're accessible in their community. People always want to talk to you.
Definitely accessible.
You know what I mean? But what is it really like when you're in council? You know, what's the experience like?
I mean, it's very, even though we have a quote-unquote part-time council, it's part-time, I call it part-time on paper and full-time in real life. I mean, we have high expectations for our council members here in Pasadena, and I think that's part of the reason why you've seen there be a male majority, an older male majority, that have been council members in years past, because it very much is a full-time endeavor in order to do the job well. Now, I don't mean that to say that if you're not retired, if you're not, you know, well financially set, that you shouldn't pursue it. But there are high expectations, and people are expected to meet that. And I think that I did, in my previous service, meet the expectations of Pasadenians, not just in District 1, but citywide, that I was accessible, that I was willing to listen to their concerns with compassion and an open mind, and being able to respectfully disagree with my colleagues on the council and come to an informed and educated decision on whatever the topic that was before us.
How did you balance working, you know, a full-time job? Because most of the other council members are either, you know, lawyers in their own firms or partners in their own firms, mm-hmm. developers, the like. I mean, how did you manage to balance the two?
I mean, I've been fortunate that at the time when I was employed, that I had supportive employers who were supportive of my public service endeavors outside of the office. And so that definitely helped in terms of being able to meet the commitments of my personal employment, but also the commitments of my public service.
I mean, how do you balance? Because, like, a couple of issues I want to jump into real quick. Housing. Mm-hmm. Like, it was an issue then.
And it's an issue
and
now.
And it's an issue now. So, obviously, that has not been corrected. But, you know, how do you even deal with that yourself? I mean, you're a young woman, you're married, family, housing is crazy. I mean, are you affected by the same housing crisis or challenges as anybody else?
Oh, for sure. And I think that is one of the issues that is bringing me to even consider running for mayor again. I mean, I've seen it with myself, I've seen it with family members, I've seen it with friends that I went to high school with. The housing market is slowly but surely pushing longtime residents of Pasadena and even newer residents of Pasadena out of the city. And we can see that exacerbates issues like our current, I will just call it a crisis that we're dealing with in school closures.
I wanted to ask you about that too.
And I know we're on limited time, but to that end, you know, I want to thank the school board members because I know they're going through a really tough time with the decisions that they're making right now. I don't believe that any one of them makes a decision to run for school board to say I'm going to close schools, but there are some tough decisions that they have to make right now. And I, with a young child, even though she's toddler age right now, those decisions are going to be on me pretty quickly coming up. And so I am closely following what's going on. And I think that both the council and the school board have to be creative in how we respond to what's happening within our school district and possibly even look outside of factors and be brave in addressing some of what's making these decisions hard, which part of it is funding. And I have always said that I think being a school board member is a much tougher job than being a city council member or even a mayor, because they essentially do not pick their budgets. It's handed to them from mm-hmm. the state, and so we have to look to the state to try to rectify some of the budget issues that they have.
I think that's a different issue in terms of how money flows from Sacramento. You know, it's pushed up and then pushed back down. But mm-hmm. from a local level, because people may not understand, you know, there were town halls or meetings organized, and we saw candidates as well as sitting council members actually attend these meetings. But these meetings have been happening for the last year.
Yes.
You know, when I sat down with Dr. McDonald back last year, you know, school closure was on the table. So
right, and it has been on the table.
It's
frankly,
been on the table.
You know,
yeah.
I've lived in this community almost my entire life. School closures have been going on slowly but surely again for a very long time.
What's the council's role? Because my understanding, and most people's understanding, is that the school board is its own governing body, and they make their own decisions other than the joint meeting that they have with the council collective. What role does a mayor, a council member have in terms of what decisions are made?
Well, one, I think a mayor and a council member has to be a champion for the public schools. Two, I believe they need to act in partnership with the school board, even though the council is not the ones making the decision. They definitely have to be in partnership, and I think the passage of Measures I and J were a reflection of that, and it was a start, but that funding is not the only reason why schools have to close. Part of it is declining enrollment, which none of us have control over. Mm-hmm. And again, at its base, the housing crisis, not just in Pasadena, but throughout the state, is part of the reason for some of those closures and declining enrollment as well, because people are leaving Pasadena to move to more economical and affordable cities. And mm-hmm. So, again, it's not a one-size-fits-all solution.
You were in favor of rent control.
Yeah. I was, and I brought it up during the last election, mm-hmm. and I think we've seen from the climate and from the decision-making that's coming down from the state, the governor's office recently signed legislation for affordable housing as well. We're seeing that the state is going to act, and it's incumbent upon us to basically be creative and craft ordinances and local legislation so that we can be ahead of the curve.
Yeah, because I know the city council can still actually act on some sort of rent stabilization, rent freeze.
Yes.
Even though the governor signed a bill into legislation that essentially caps rent.
Yes.
7% once you
yes.
add in.
Yes. And I'm appreciative of the work that the council has done to try to respond mm-hmm. To the crisis with the tenant protection ordinance improvements. But we have to go a little bit further. There is no one solution. I understand that a majority of the council, as it currently is constituted, does not support rent control. Mm-hmm. But I do think that it's something that can be added to our toolbox of helping to resolve.
Why do you think they don't support it?
I mean, one may be because they're not currently in a life position of where they are renters, so maybe it's because they're homeowners and they have, you know, business interests that they think about as a first priority versus renters' interests, which is totally fine. But, you know, I think I saw a statistic that said 56% of the city are renters. And again,
it's much higher than that, nearly 67%.
Okay, yeah. 67%. And mm-hmm. so clearly it's something that the community is asking the council to take a stand on, whether that's for or against.
Mm-hmm. Your role, you know, as a council person when you were there can be troubling, it can be emotional, it can be difficult. I mean, you have to deal with a lot of things. Let's roll in package number 5, and then we'll talk with Jacque on the other side of it.
Perhaps the most memorable part of the night happened when Mantle asked what the candidates bucked their constituents on. Robinson said she couldn't think of anything, then broke down into tears, saying she would tell the crowd how difficult it had been talking with the families of the shooting victims.
I've been to the site of every single gun shooting in this city, and that's not something that I talk about, whether it's officer involved or not. It's hard. Whether it's officer involved or not, it's hard. It's hard to look a mother in her face and tell her that I'm sorry for an action that I didn't personally participate in, but because I'm a member of the city council, I feel like I have a certain responsibility.
And welcome back. I know the incidents that happened. Why was that so emotional for you, though?
Because it is hard. I think people sometimes don't realize that being the mayor or being a city council member is not all, you know, babies and hugs and waving in parades. You know, it's the difficult parts like that, you know, appearing in front of families that have lost their loved one. And I think compassion is a part of being an effective council member and mayor. And you don't always get to stand in front of supportive crowds, mm-hmm. so to speak. And so you have to be willing to deal with the difficult times as well as the happy times.
Well, Jacque, I appreciate you taking time today and sitting down with me. And can I have you back once we figure out what's really going on and what you're going to do?
Absolutely. Thank you for having me today.
Absolutely. You're watching The Conversation Live. Conversation Live focuses on social justice, restorative justice, inclusion, and equality. Before we get ready to get out of here, I want to just remind you that we are having an election coming up. I want to roll in segment 6, this final tribute to Honorable Elijah Cummings, and we'll sign off on the other side.
My father had never been in the Capitol building. He said, isn't this the place where they used to call us slaves? I said, yes, sir. And isn't this the place they used to call us three-fifths of a man? I said, yes, sir. And isn't this the place that they used to call us chattel? I said, yes, sir. He said, you know, and he said these words, Steve, and I'll never forget. He said, when I think about you being sworn in today, he said, now I see what I could have been.
I say to the American people that if you want your government to do more to address the issues that matter most to you, then you need to vote. And you got to vote like you've never voted before. 1 year ago today, on my mother's dying bed at 92 years old, former sharecropper, her last words were she had fought and seen people harmed, beaten, trying to vote. Talk about inalienable rights. Voting is crucial. And I don't give a damn how you look at it. There are efforts to stop people from voting. That's not right. And this time, all of our votes will be counted.
He fought for Baltimore.
Till we have another opportunity to speak with you, as always, Agape.
Conversation Live is brought to you by